Presentation about pre-rendering media sets with Next.js and Netlify. My name is Wolfgang Ziegler, or Fago on VidoTop. My Twitter handle is CyrilFago. You might know me like from some of my Drupal contributions already. I worked a lot on Drupal 8 Entity API for Core, and I'm also like maintainer of the Type Data API in Core. And in Drupal 7, I wrote quite some popular Drupal content modules like rules, entity API, or field collection. I'm running a small Drupal company, Tronomics GmbH in Vienna, and I'm working there as CEO, CTO. So what's pre-rendering actually? So pre-rendering is like basically when you have a data source, like in our case Drupal, and some sort of pre-rendering process which generates static files. So that's very convenient because static files are really fast. So why would you do it? It's fast and it's also like very robust because static files, once they're up, they are up and there's like no way of that service basically breaking it very easily. And then pre-generation is also a very easy way to decouple because like there are all of the modern front-end frameworks, there are also like tools for pre-rendering, so you can use them. And that way you can decouple also without any SEO concerns, or you can also like really keep the hosting cost and the complexity down because you don't have any Node.js server-side rendering stack to maintain and run. So that's like really a good and simple way to get started with all the modern front-end frameworks. So in this presentation, I'm talking about Next.js. So what's Next.js? It's a progressive Vue.js framework. So what's Vue.js? Vue.js actually is a very approachable modern front-end library. It's one of the main alternatives to React, I would say. And we decided to use Vue because it's like really an approachable library. So it tries to stick to the HTML standards, what makes it very easy to get into. It has great documentation. Also, it's very versatile. It's easy to get started on it. And it's also incrementally adoptable. So there's like a Vue router, a Vue store, like all of that kind of official companion libraries that you can just decide that you want that you can use together with the main rendering library in case you need it. So it's like less choices compared to React, which makes it also very convenient to work with because it's just all there and integrated. And finally, it's also very fast. The library is not large. It also uses a virtual DOM similar to React. And then Next.js, it follows basically the Vue.js principles, but it's like a fully fledged framework which includes everything that you need for a proper web application. So it has all the webpack, JavaScript transpilation set up, all the CSS preprocessing and everything configured. It's like an easy way to configure your routes, which automatically get automatic code splitting for optimal front-end performance and so on. It's built modular, so there are like modules like for progressive web apps or Axios, which you can add to the stack very easily. And in the end, yeah, it's just performant and very enjoyable to work with. But then it also has the nice feature of different rendering modes. So like by default, what you can do like with many frameworks very easily is that you have like a single page application, what means you have some small initial HTML page which just delivers the JavaScript application, and from there on everything is JavaScript and you just use the APIs. But then it also has a server-side rendering mode, what means basically you have the same code running on the server and on the client to render a site, what's very convenient and good for SEO. And of course, there's the statically generation mode, which I'm talking about here. So you can use it to pre-render stuff into static files, so you don't need a server to host things. And from there on, actually, you can also combine it with the single page application approach to use APIs. Then Netlify is a hosting or like a general platform for running static sites. It's integrated with Git and GitHub, and I also think like Bitbucket and GitLab. So it reacts on the webhooks and automatically deploys your code from there. What's really nice and convenient, so it also integrates with the branches, pull request workflows, can get you an automated preview on your pull request and all those things very easily. And it does that by basically just running the pre-generation in the build process for you automatically. And then at the end of the pre-generation process, there are the static files, which basically it puts into the CDN and serves for you automatically. And it does that by leveraging atomic deployments for your files. You get SSL, it's automatically managed, all in a CDN, and it even has a free tier. So it's like really easy to get started and work with that, and it's just convenient to use. And in particular, it's also very convenient and easy to work together with Nuxt.js. So basically, when you want to try and get a feeling for those things, I can just recommend to follow those three steps. It's really, really quick. So you can just run that command like npx create Nuxt app. You get a new project. You push it into GitHub repository. Then you log into netlify.com. You can connect it to GitHub. You basically paste that build command and npm run generate, and you can deploy it. That's really everything that's needed to get it going. It takes in about 50 seconds to build. I just tried it yesterday quickly, and you will get up a page, which you don't see. So yeah, that's basically it. Yeah, so that's really great setup for serving content. So when you have like steady content to serve, you can have Drupal as an editorial application in the back, and like once something changed, you can just trigger a new Netlify build, and the whole site gets rebuilt. There's also an API, so you can also like provide a button click for your editors to rebuild the site, or even determine automatically when there are changes. Then from there, the deployment just happens automatically via Netlify, and you get all the benefits of the like fast and reliable hosting and CDN. So that's quite nice, but how do you do, like with that setup, like how do you do instant updates when an editor changes, get a quick update, or handling large amounts of content? As you can imagine, it might be difficult, like pre-generating like really large sites. Also like handling personalized content, of course it's pre-generated, so it's the same for everyone. So for personalized content, you can just use the APIs. So you have a general pre-generated site, basically as Google would see it, and from there on you can use JavaScript, you can use JavaScript-based logins and login via API, and then also you can fetch additional data via APIs, and based on that data, use Vue.js to handle the, or let it handle the updates to the DOM and have updated content for the user. So that's actually a good way to do that. For instant updates, basically what you could do is like just regularly pre-generate static sites. It depends on how instant you need your updates. If it's just like every 5 minutes and you have a small site, that might be fine. But still, that might be not fresh enough. So what you can also do is that you then have the APIs look for more recent content after page load and fetch that and then update the site of the initial page load. So that's also like a quite easy way to get some fresh content on a static site in addition. But when it comes to handling massive amounts of content, it actually turns out to be a little bit more difficult. So yeah. Pre-rendering huge amounts of content, as you can think, can just take time. So with Nuxt.js, it's about like 12,000 pages. It would take about 20 minutes to pre-render all that. So the ideal setup would be if the framework would know, okay, something changed, so only those 10 pages changed. So I only need to pre-render those and update those. But that's actually not there, so that's not working. And I also don't know it from any other static chat generator to have that feature right now. I actually think Thomas, the Drupal module, which is a static site generator available for Drupal, can do that, but I never tried that, I must say. But in that setup, so what we came up with as a solution basically is just say, okay, we take the pre-rendering for the pretty much static parts, and then we deliver the main content via Drupal, so we have like the benefits of both worlds. So if you get on a typical media site, like what you usually have, like in the footer and the header and all the navigation, it's pretty much the same across all the pages. So that actually makes sense to have pre-rendered. So what you can do is basically, yeah, you pre-render that, the header, the footer, navigation, and then you take like the dynamic content from Drupal, and then you put it together and have your complete page, like with the header and footer like being pre-rendered and the main content being dynamically served to Drupal. So you might wonder, so yeah, okay, then you're back to rendering on the backend again, so where's the benefit? So what we figured what we can do is that we don't do a full rendering on the backend still, so we just render simplified markup that turns out to use so-called custom elements. And that custom elements then we can very easily render on the front-end on the client side with Vue.js. So on that slide you see two examples of custom elements for like a quote paragraph and a Twitter paragraph. And that's actually the markup that we decided to use for those paragraphs. So that if you see the quote, it just has the regular quote content as some nested HTML. And it also uses some special tags, like the offer tag, to denote like a special so-called slot, which then the frontend can use to work with and to style it accordingly. And the same way for the Twitter paragraph, where the main thing actually is just the source to the tweet, and there the rest can really be done on the front end already. So given that, combined like the static pre-generated page shell with the dynamic content and custom elements, basically what we figured, what we are creating is really a new way of decoupling Drupal. So we call it basically Lupus Decoupled Drupal. And I'd like to show you that a little bit closer and explain it a little bit more how that's working. So, as mentioned, we pre-render the page shell, but the pre-rendering and the dynamic content needs to be combined at some stage. So in the beginning, we have a front proxy, a small application, which pre-builds the page responses for the users. So when a request comes in, it will fetch the pre-generated page shell from the static site hosting, like from Netlify, and it will fetch the main dynamic content from the API from Drupal, and will give the response to the user. So the user will get basically all the full HTML, the pre-generated site with the dynamic content in it. And actually, it will forward all the headers, the cookies, and the sessions to Drupal. So what turns out quite nice is that all the form submissions code, the sessions, and everything, it's just working. So you can still use it. So you get the decoupled rendering, but you get still all the Drupal features. So we have a small package on GitHub which does that front proxy handling. It's actually a quite simple PHP package. Nothing special really, but the way it's working is like when you have a user coming to a URL at a certain path, it just requests the same path with an API prefix from Drupal, and it also requests the statically pre-built page shell, combines it, and returns it. For getting the API response from Drupal, we did a small module which we called the Lupus Custom Elements Renderer module. It basically leverages the possibility from Drupal to switch out the main content renderer. That means instead of a regular page response where Drupal would take the main content and take it your blocks layout and put it into your blocks page, it will not take the blocks layout but just deliver the main content in a small JSON response, which in addition to the main content has some necessary page metadata like the page title or the page meta tags, breadcrumbs, everything basically the frontend would need in addition to the main content to have a full working page. And given that, it's also possible to do client-side route changes. So the first page request, as explained, is just handled by the front proxy, but subsequent page requests then can be handled by client-side application by client-side route changes. So the client-side JavaScript can just fetch the via API the content after clicking on a link, and it then can take in the content from the API response and also the page metadata like the title, and add it into the page, and still the page will be updated as usual, as like the framework Vue.js will be taking care of handling the updates. And that's actually quite nice, since it results in a better user experience and performance for the user, as it helps to avoid the full page reloads. Speaking about custom elements, so they are actually the key part of like making the dynamic content rendered properly on the client side, and that's actually something that you cannot only do with Vue.js. You can also like work with web component, which what is actually exactly that approach, but or also like React. There's like also library which you could use it with React together. So there are many different approaches actually for rendering custom elements on the front end, and you could use that approach with any kind of front-end framework which is able to do that. And what's also nice about the custom element is actually that they are SEO friendly without you having to do any Node.js server-side rendering, since the HTML responses, they come with all the regular content in there. As I've shown before, it's also like the content is like just in part of like nested markup. So it's all in there. And also custom elements, it's like not just an invention of some library. It's like there's also like really a standardization process, as it's like standardized as part of the W3C, as part of the web component movements. So custom elements is one of the specs which are part of the web component spec, essentially. And what you get in the end is really a nice, simple, and clean markup for your content, but actually also really convenient. And speaking of SEO, it makes sense that you also like take care of rendering essential data with your with standard HTML tags and attributes. So, like for example, links are really SEO relevant. So this is how we make sure if you have a teaser on a site that usually links to another node, so it makes a lot of sense that Google is aware of that. So that is working by having a special attribute is, which like Vue understands to tell Vue this actually is a teaser-wide component, and it will know how to render it and how to pick it up. But at the same point, it's like a regular anchor tag, and also Google will know to interpret that. So for that, there's the custom elements module, which helps you with rendering entities into the custom elements markup. It also comes like with custom elements Evermere submodule, which turns it all on by default, and it works. It has a similar API like the Symfony serialization API, and it's also compatible with the layered builder module, which makes it quite nice. So with that, we basically have a simple, novel approach for progressively decoupling Drupal. It allows you to decouple your front-end rendering from the back-end very easily, while you still stay in control with the back-end. So you still have like all the routing, all the URLs, path aliases, form processing or sessions. So that's actually quite handy to not lose that. So so you don't lose all the things that Drupal provides to you. And speaking of that, you can also like leverage all the caching capabilities, like easy caching and scalability. As usual with Drupal, you just need to take care of caching your API responses, which is a regular single Drupal response. So you get to use the advantages of the decoupled frontend. Editors and site managers can still stay in control. You can even use like things like the layout builder. You have good performance, like you don't need to take care about cache tags for things like the page shell. It's already pre-generated, and you don't have to do like Node.js hosting if you don't want to. The downside, of course, you have a custom architecture that your team needs to understand, But if you're really into it, you can also, as I mentioned, there's Nuxt.js rendering as an option, so you can decide to use that and turn it on. But I won't go into details here since we're out of time. So thanks for the presentation. Join us for the contribution opportunities, and don't forget to rate the session. If there are any questions, I don't know if we have time for questions. No, so you can catch me on in the hallway. I'm happy to answer that.